My name is David Bobb, and I serve as director of the Hillsdale College Center, Kirby Center for Constitutional Studies and Citizenship. It's my pleasure this morning to welcome you. We're excited about this morning's conference. It's on a very important and timely topic, balancing national defense interests and press freedom. This is a joint conference, a program of the Kirby Center and the Center for Security Policy and their new National Security and New Media Journalism project directed by Bill Gertz, from whom you'll hear much today. The Kirby Center marks an extension of Hillsdale College's commitment to the Constitution through teaching the enduring principles of the American Declaration of Independence and the Constitution. The Kirby Center seeks to inspire citizens, that is students, teachers, policymakers, and elected officials, to defend those principles as part of their daily life. Hillsdale College is pleased today to partner with the Center for Security Policy, whose valuable work has now for nearly 25 years much elevated the American debate about American national security priorities. Our jointly sponsored program today has a relatively simple point of departure. The government of the United States, we believe, should abide by its constitutional limitations so that it can do the things that it constitutionally must do. A government that throws off constitutional restraints is unable over time to ensure the liberty of its citizens and to protect the national security interests of the nation as a whole. Today, our distinguished panelists will offer guidance on an important and timely question rooted in those timeless principles. This question is how we can balance national defense interests and press freedom. And I'm glad that today their challenge is to offer the answers, because that's an awfully tough question. Moderating this panel discussion is the founder and president of the Center for Security Policy, Frank Gaffney. Formerly Assistant Director of Defense for International Security Policy under President Ronald Reagan, Mr. Gaffney also was Deputy Assistant Secretary of Defense for Nuclear Forces and Arms Control Policy under President Reagan. He brings a wealth of experience and wisdom in this area. He's the publisher most recently of a book that I would commend to your attention, Sharia, The Threat to America, which includes an introduction by R. James Woolsey, former CIA director and our most distinguished of panelists today. Mr. Gaffney is also the host, I should mention, of Secure Freedom Radio, a national syndicated radio program. Please join me this morning in welcoming Frank Gaffney.
Good morning. Let me add my word of welcome as well to you all, and my word of thanks to David and Larry Arne and all of the folks here at Hillsdale. This is the first time I've been in this beautiful facility, and congratulations on establishing such an extraordinary presence here on Capitol Hill, as well as the presence that Hillsdale has long had elsewhere around the country. It's great to be partnered with you on this event, and we hope on many other projects going forward, David. I'm particularly excited about this one, and I'm going to make a few brief opening comments and then turn it over to the project's director to tell you a bit more about it, Bill Gertz. One of the things that it's not quite 25 years to be precise, it's about 23 years we've been working on national security policy under the banner of the Center for Security Policy. And it's been clear throughout that time that the founders' premise that this republic would be rooted in the decision-making of an informed electorate was critical to our survival, in fact, not just our prosperity and our success, but our survival. And the question that kept coming up over those years is there an adequately informed electorate to make the kinds of informed decisions that would assure the survival of the republic? And the founders, I think, premised this whole structure on two basic ideas, and David and Hillsdale are much more knowledgeable about their thinking and their architecture than I, but two that I've certainly taken away from my study are that you would invest the vote in people who actually had a stake in the outcome. And they started, as you all know, by selecting only males, white males at that, and white males who actually owned property to have a vote. Well, over the years, of course, we've seen the merit of extending the mandate to universal suffrage, which placed an even greater importance, I think, because not everybody had the same kind of stake. I mean, you'd think they would, but they didn't necessarily think they did, as did those property holders who really had everything on the line. So the other principal tool that the founders, I think, counted on to ensure the electorate would be properly informed was a free press, guaranteed in the First Amendment to the Constitution. And we have, for many years, had a struggle, particularly in the post-war years, and I mean post-war going back probably to World War I, really, not just World War II, but since the United States emerged as a world power, there have been tensions between what can be made known to the public and what must be safeguarded in their interest, their security interests specifically. So I anticipate that we will spend most of the morning talking about that tension and where to draw the line and how one must operate, whether one is doing so as a government official working to assure the safety of the public and keep them informed, or whether one is a member of the press whose job is basically to keep them informed whether the government wants them to be informed or not, because they have, at least in principle, a right to know. So those are sort of the broad themes that I think we're going to focus on. Let me just mention a couple of specific examples of places where it seems to me the public has got to be more informed, and these may be examples of places where this dynamic tension is playing out. They're ones I happen to be particularly seized with, so forgive me if they seem as though they may not be top of mind for most of you, but for precisely that reason, really, I think they're good examples of the problem I'm talking about, how to have an informed electorate knowledgeable about, in particular, the national security challenges that we face and what's being done about them, or in some cases not. For example, the book that David was kind enough to flog earlier, which I will repeat, I think is really, particularly for those of you who are spending your summers here interning to get your first, perhaps, exposure to government. It's called Sharia, the Threat to America. Jim Woolsey was one of the eminent authors, 19 all told, who participated in its preparation. It addresses a problem that I submit to you we simply do not have a clue about. And I don't mean narrowly the problem of Sharia. I'm talking about how it manifests itself, and specifically how this political, military, legal doctrine, forgive me, Diana West, another of the co-authors, is also here, member of the working press. But people have some appreciation of Sharia law, but very little appreciation of how it is animating jihad, not just of the violent kind, but of a stealthy kind. And I hope the panel in our back and forth might discuss a little bit about how are we doing in our understanding of the extent to which organizations like the Muslim Brotherhood, who are promoting this stealth jihad inside the United States, are doing so almost completely unremarked. In fact, are doing so, in some instances, with representatives of the United States government in regular meetings and outreach efforts with them. So Sharia is an example of something we need to be informed about, and I think the press, as well as our government officials, are going to need to be talking more, hopefully in the course of the program here, about it. Another very important issue involves the ultimate guarantee of our security, our deterrent, our nuclear forces. And as Jim Woolsey, who has served on successive commissions looking into the status of our forces, can attest, it's not good. Very few people in this country are aware that we have allowed it to steadily atrophy over the years. Now to find ourselves with a president who thinks it's a good idea for the world to be rid of these weapons, and therefore, I think, accelerating this kind of program. That seems to me to be something an informed electorate needs to be more knowledgeable about and to be equipped to debate, especially in the course of the upcoming election cycle. A third issue, our hemisphere. Those of you who are students of Latin America, if there are any of you who are probably aware of the rising influence of people who are deeply hostile to the United States. Hugo Chavez of Venezuela being the most sort of obvious example. This, combined with the presence in our hemisphere increasingly of nations and terrorist organizations that share that enmity to the United States, has the most profound implications for our security. Even if you were not seeing what is increasingly looking like open civil war in our immediate neighbor to the south, the proximity of hostile nations, groups, and the like to us is something we should be talking about. We should be thinking about. We should be addressing as a matter of informed voters. Finally, a matter that Bill Gertz, I know, and others of this distinguished panel have been thinking a lot about. Where are we going with decisions that are now in the offing, some of which George's boss is presumably going to be presiding over in his imminent new capacity as Secretary of Defense, to cut our defense spending and forces and investment? What will the implications be? Do we understand? Really understand where this idea, particularly of a $400 billion cut over 12 years, will take us? I think we have not got our hands around this, and I'm hoping that today's conversation, and indeed the project that Bill Gertz is heading, which we hope will be an ongoing contributor to both the national security and the reporting on it, that this conversation today will be a good first step in addressing these sorts of issues and ensuring that we live up to the founders' expectation that we will be making informed electoral decisions, particularly in 2012. So with that, let me introduce Bill Gertz. He is the national security editor of the Washington Times. He writes a terrific must-read column called Inside the Ring. He has been reporting on these sorts of issues and challenges for decades. He is, I think, regarded by competitors and colleagues alike as one of the best in the business, and it's a great privilege to have him working with us in his spare time on this new project at the Center for Security Policy. Bill Gertz. So we're going to pass this mic start. Like a baton. So.
Thank you, Frank. The idea behind this conference is to try to educate and sensitize. Let's look at some of the issues, and we've got a host of issues. I'm going to make some brief remarks. Each person will go back and forth and give about a 5-minute intro, and then we'll have a discussion back and forth, and then we'll leave some time for questions at the end. The idea is to educate and sensitize. There's been a lot of issues. I've been reporting on sensitive national security information since the 1980s, going back to the Reagan administration. I've been threatened with prosecution a number of times under a number of different statutes. I've been subpoenaed and I'm still in the business. We, in the newsroom, one of the things that we like to say is that the less we report on leaks and prosecutions of leaks, the better, because it makes it much harder to do our jobs because we're so reliant on sources. But as was mentioned earlier, the framers of the Constitution, the founders of the country, they were skeptical of powerful central government. They made three branches of government, and then they went a step further and they made a free press. And in my experience, and I didn't have this when I started back in the 80s, the press plays a vital role in U.S. national security. How does it do that? By providing that sunlight, by providing that focus on what's going on in government. And I think all you need to do is look around the world to the unfree countries and where there's unfree press, and you'll see corruption and dictatorship. Those are the dominant features. So a free press is fundamental to our open system. It doesn't always work out. The relations between government and the press have never been good, but right now I would say that my view is that press freedom is under assault. This was my statement when I was subpoenaed back in 2007 in a Chinese spy case in California, and I went out there and the judge said, "Thank you for coming," as if I had a choice. And he tried to get me to disclose my sources, and I had a very good lawyer, and basically we submitted a statement in advance telling the judge, "Here's what I know, here's what I'm going to say, and here's what I'm not going to say." And the judge backed down and basically praised my reporting, said that I was doing a service to the country by reporting on Chinese intelligence gathering operations. But my problem wasn't over, and I was subpoenaed again, and eventually that went away. So my point is there's almost unlimited freedom here. There's few areas where the press is constrained. Libel is one. There's communications intelligence statute going back to the 50s, which really nobody's really been prosecuted under that. And then there's the Agents Identities Protection Act, which we know was the Valerie Plame, the motivation for the Valerie Plame case. So the role of the press is to provide information and also to provide a check on government, and that's where this idea of sensitive information comes out. And it comes out because sources go to the press. The motivation is generally that they see some wrongdoing, that's the whistleblower motivation, or the other is the policy influence motivation. In other words, they want to influence a policy, whether it's something happening in Congress or something happening within the administration. In the news business, we say you're only as good as your sources, so we're reliant on sources. We develop sources. We have an extremely open government. People provide reporters with lots of information, and then that's where this comes in. When do you report? First, I don't report. I don't reveal secrets. I report the news. So when I get information, I look at it through the news prism, and that prism says, one, is this information accurate? It's often very difficult to determine that. It may take a long time. And two, is it news? It has to fit to that category, that broad category of news. So when the decision is, we don't clear our stories in advance with the government, but we try to have an interaction with the government in the normal course of reporting. I can remember back in the 80s, the CIA's policy was we don't comment on anything for the most part. And then what happened was the Washington Post reported on a program, a CIA security training program in Lebanon, where CIA trainers had trained Lebanese security personnel, and those personnel went out and blew up a radical cleric. And the Post story was that the CIA was somehow linked to that bombing. And that was kind of a watershed point. And after that, the government began to change its policy, and they realized that it might be better to engage the press when there is misinformation, and in the hopes that they could shape or influence some of the stories. And that's changed a great deal now. There is a lot more interaction. Again, publication versus secrecy. The threshold for us is generally we don't want to report something that's going to get somebody killed. Can we know when that happens? We can't always know that. We rely on a number of outside experts who can advise us on that. We rely on our own editorial experience. But when it comes to communications intelligence, it's a little more difficult call. Many times, and I don't think a lot of press critics appreciate this, the press does withhold information. We don't report. The problem is, when we do that, people who have given us the information can go to another news outlet, and that's happened to me on a number of occasions. I'll just sum up by saying I think American interests are served by a free and open press, and specifically the need for confidential sources is critical. I mean, that's really the lifeblood of a free press. The ability to have people who can give you information outside of a controlled government system. I'll stop there.
Bill, thank you very much. Next, we're going to talk to former CIA Director Jim Woolsey, a man who has distinguished himself in many respects, but not least by his ability to work equally well with Republicans and Democrats, and do so, I think, to the great betterment of the national security. We're delighted to have him with us, particularly because of the vantage point, I guess I should say, that he brings to these issues of what needs to be covered, what the public needs to know, and what it doesn't. Jim, thank you.
Thanks, Frank. Let me take just a few minutes to see if I can kind of set the stage about how the conflict in the world in which we are engaged now differs so fundamentally from that of the Cold War, which shaped most of our attitudes and our practices with respect to journalism and everything else. First of all, there are days when I have a certain nostalgia for the Cold War. It had a certain simplicity to it. We were worried about a Soviet conventional attack in Europe. We were worried that that might develop into nuclear war. So we planned fairly carefully with our allies how to contain the Soviets, how to deter them, how to be able to fight them conventionally if we had to. It more or less worked. After some 45 years, their virtually completely dysfunctional economy collapsed, we won. The Soviet Union went away about 20 years ago. Eastern Europe was freed. It's not as if the world is an ideal place in the country of Russia and some surrounding it now. But it's a better situation, certainly for the people of Eastern Europe, than it was, and there's no real day-to-day risk that some miscalculation may cause nuclear war between the U.S. and the Soviet Union. The ideology of the times and of the Cold War was also something that was pretty straightforward. I would say that although Marxism-Leninism, revolutionary Marxism-Leninism, communism, had a real grip on a number of people in the world as true believers back in the 20s and 30s, maybe through the 40s, particularly given our alliance, wartime alliance with Stalin. But by the time of Khrushchev's 20th Party Congress speech laying out all of Stalin's crimes, I'd say once you got into the 60s and 70s, 80s, there were probably more true-believing communists in the bookstores of the Upper West Side of Manhattan than there were in the Kremlin. I negotiated with those guys four times, and I got to know them reasonably well. Not a one of them, as far as I was aware, wanted to die for the principle of from each according to his ability to each according to his need. They didn't want to die at all. They wanted to remodel their dachas. And I think that we used to a world in which our enemy, from the late 50s on really, was kind of a group of bureaucratic thugs with a cover story, and Marxism-Leninism. Full stop. The world we're in today has a number of features that are fundamentally different from what we were going through in the Cold War, and which create very, very different types of problems for us, particularly in this world of what the press reports and how well it can help us as citizens understand what's going on and what it should print and what it should not. One of the reasons is that we have a situation now with the internet in which aggression can be instantaneous. We had an instrumentality that I helped draft, actually, in 1973, called the War Powers Resolution, in which if the Constitution, if the both legislature and the president agreed that it applied, the mechanism could work. You could consult with the Congress and get a resolution before you intervened in a war somewhere, a 20th century war. Today, war may begin with one stroke of a mouse, because the enemy has put malware inside the SCADA, supervisory control and data acquisition systems, which are used to control our electric grid. And the difference between an enemy exploring and hacking into the electric grid to see how it works, maybe just for mischief, and the enemy being able to hit a key and shut down important parts of the grid, which would be as great an act of aggression against the United States as even a nuclear war, that's because we have 18 critical infrastructures in the country, and all 17 of the others depend on electricity. So if the electricity goes down for any appreciable time, you don't have water, you don't have sewage pumping, you don't have anything. So the technology creates a situation in which we may well not know who the aggressor is. There's a new book out by Davidow called Overconnected, The Promise and Threat of the Internet. Look at WikiLeaks. One private first class hacks into hundreds of thousands of secret level communications of the United States government. Why? Because the CIPRNet, the secret level internet, is modeled on the internet. It just has fewer people in it and some controls. Why is that a bad thing? It's a bad thing because the internet is not established on the principle of having any security at all. You can try to put firewalls and things in, but it's very difficult. The internet assumes we all are fine and we all want to communicate with one another. Here we go. But suppose somebody wants to add one stroke of the key and take down a chunk of the electric grid. That's a world that we've never lived in before. And as far as ideology is concerned, the situation we face now is extraordinary and not like anything really in our experience. We live in a world in which an offshoot, I'll call it that, Islamism, of one of the world's great religions, Islam, has a worldview that it wants us to live in a caliphate, a theocratic dictatorship. It wants all you women here in burqas, and so on. And that ideology, we need to be clear about. We need to talk about, we need to understand, we need to not be politically correct about it. We do not have to criticize Islam as Islam, but you can't understand what's going on in the world of our threat from terrorism and the rest without realizing that this movement, Islamism, is an offshoot of one of the world's great religions. Any of us been around in the 1490s and seen Torquemada and those who were with him burning dissident Christians, Jews, and Muslims at the stake in Spain, I doubt if any of us would have accepted that if we were critical of that, we were Christian phobes. No. The Inquisition was a terrible offshoot of one of the world's great religions. And those who struggled against it and eventually brought it to an end deserve our admiration. We shouldn't call them Christian phobes. And for those of you, like Frank Gaffney and others, who are working hard to help us take a stand and be effective in dealing with the Islamist-sponsored terrorism and movements, we don't advance the cause of clarity by calling Islamist terrorists anger management challenged candidates for therapy. Actually, I made that up, but it could well have come from the Department of Euphemism in the office, a certain office in the executive branch. We need to be clear, and Frank has led a number of us into putting together this this book, which helps begin that way. But you have a very, very difficult set of tasks set before you, given the technology of our age and given the ideology that we struggle against.
Jim, thank you very much. Next, we're going to alternate between folks with the policy responsibilities or background and folks who are in the working press or have been. We're going to start with Stephen Hayes, who is currently a senior writer at the Weekly Standard and the author of two New York Times bestsellers, The Connection and Cheney. You see him frequently on Fox, and he does some of the best spade work on national security reporting of anybody I know. So, Steve, we're delighted to have you.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. I'm here probably for the same reasons that most of you are here, which is to hear everybody else here talk. So I will be very brief and try to tell a couple of stories to give examples of the kind of decision-making that takes place beyond sort of the theoretical on what to publish and when to publish and how to report on these sensitive issues. I went to journalism school back in the late 1990s, grad school in journalism, and I took a course, ethics in journalism, that was a required course for everybody there. And one of the things we discussed at some length was national security reporting. And so you had all of these exercises, some role-playing, some just theoretical discussions about what you would do in various situations about reporting or not reporting pieces of information. And after a few days on the subject, I noticed a pattern. The answer was always, report it. And that struck me as odd, as somebody who's an American citizen and unapologetically on a team. I'm an American, I think that way when I report. And it may not be the way that sophisticated journalism academics like to hear people talk, but it's the way that I think about the way I do my job. So I was a little surprised that this was the way that journalists and journalism academics talked about what to publish and when to publish. Everything was sort of go and go as quickly as you can. Well, when I started at the Weekly Standard, I came to the magazine actually looking to do work on politics. Most of my reporting had been on electoral politics. I'd worked at a publication called The Hotline, which is like a digest of electoral politics, campaigns and elections. And that's what I thought I was going to do in the summer of 2001. I did a big investigative piece on Andrew Cuomo, who had just come off his time as Secretary of HUD and wanted to run for governor of New York. And you know, I spent 3 months on this thing, more or less, and thought I was doing the most important work in the world. And then September 11th happened. And I got on a train that day and went to New York City and was going to New York City actually to do what was to be a straightforward profile of Hillary Clinton, to find out how people who hold elective office, at the time she was a senator from New York, deal with situations like this. And I tried to get a hold of her and tried to follow her around. Well, it didn't work, and her people would understandably not, wasn't their highest priority. And I probably wouldn't have been had I been working for CNN, but I certainly wasn't when I was working for the Weekly Standard. I tried to get to Ground Zero, and they had constructed within hours of the attacks these concentric circles, checkpoints about a mile out, and then you'd move a couple blocks and there'd be another checkpoint, another couple blocks. And I went on this first day to the first checkpoint and walked up in a hurry, and I was wearing sort of khakis and a sport coat, no tie, but I had my press credentials around my neck, and I flashed my press credentials and said, I'm looking for Hillary Clinton, I'm supposed to be with Hillary Clinton. And the police officer misunderstood me as meaning I work with Hillary Clinton, I have some right to be next to Hillary Clinton, and sort of through. And I stopped for a second and thought, well, that worked pretty well. And I walked to the next checkpoint, and I was very hurried and agitated and said, I need to find Hillary Clinton, flashed my credentials, and waved me through. And this happened again and again and again. The point where I actually got to Ground Zero was standing at the hole that day, and it was a rather amazing experience. I'd call it not deception, but strategic ambiguity I wasn't that specific about what I was doing. Fast forward a little bit, there was the run-up to the Iraq War. I was looking at the nature of the threat from Saddam Hussein and Saddam's Iraq, and I did what any good reporter would do. I went back and I looked at as much material as I could about what Saddam had been up to over the past decade. And I spent a lot of time, you know, LexisNexis was my best friend. I read everything that there was to read about the sanctions battles, the going back into the first Gulf War on forward. And one of the things that really stood out to me in this research was the amount of reporting about Saddam's support for Islamists, for jihadist terrorists, that really wasn't getting much attention, I thought, in the mainstream press. This is in 2002, 2003 timeframe. So I went, and you know, I guess the formal name for this would be open sources. I went and consulted, you know, old reports from the Associated Press, and looking at the things that Bill Clinton said when he went in February of 1998 and gave a speech at the Pentagon, and these things, and looked at the arguments that were being made and noticed that they weren't being made in the context of the Bush administration. People weren't talking about Saddam's support for jihadists in the past, and looked at the Newsweek article that had provided great detail about these Islamist conferences that Saddam held in Baghdad every year, that one Newsweek reporter described as a precursor to Al-Qaeda. Rather extraordinary open source reporting. So I went back and looked at this and reported on it at some length. After a time, I obtained a government document, a classified document, and it laid out in tremendous detail, I believe it was 50 some odd pages, a history of Saddam's support for jihadist terrorism. Now, some of the information was good, some of the information was less good. It was obvious, even at first glance to an amateur, which I was, that some of it just didn't add up, wouldn't check out, but a lot of it was, so I raced around and called as many people as I could to report out the details in this memo. And the other thing I did, we had great concerns at the Weekly Standard about publishing some of the information in this memo. At this place, the war had taken place. Much of the information was good contextual information, but it was unlikely to be the kind of information that would, as Bill said, jeopardize lives or what have you. Excuse me. So I impaneled, with the help of my editors at the magazine, sort of an ad hoc committee of intelligence experts, people who had lived lives reading these top secret documents, and sent them this this classified memo and said, could you please read it through? Don't share it with anyone. It was a great risk. I was worried that if we shared it with people, they would share it with somebody else and I'd be scooped. Could you please read this through and tell us what we can and what we can't publish? You give us some idea of what we can include in a story that we wanted to do. So we did this, and most of it, I think, was okay for publication, despite the fact that it was classified, unlikely to jeopardize sources, either how we obtained the information or methods. But there was a cost in doing this, and the cost in doing this was that when we reported on some of these things, we were not allowed to, or chose not to, it had been suggested to us that we not include sourcing on some of the information. Most of it, the kind of information that would be, you know, highly technical, telephone intercepts, things of that nature. And we decided that we weren't going to include that. And by not including that, I think in some respects, we took a hit on the other side because people couldn't see the quality of the sourcing of the information. So I'll stop there and share more later. Thanks.
Stephen, thank you very much. War stories add a lot to the texture of this. A guy who's got some more stories, but he can't tell us because he'd have to kill us, is George Little, who is currently the Director of Public Affairs at the Central Intelligence Agency. He has been serving in the media sort of side of the agency for a time and previously worked in the strategic planning department at the National Counterterrorism Center. So he's got both policy and press relations backgrounds, and it's a great add to this panel. Thank you for joining us, George.
Thank you for having me here today, Frank and Bill and others. I have no comment.
No.
I, I'm actually, some of you are probably wondering why the CIA has a public affairs office. I'm actually appearing here in disguise. It's been a good couple of months, to be honest with you, in CIA public affairs. The successful bin Laden operation has given us more media attention, probably more positive media attention than we've had in quite some time. I was coming out of the White House with the director shortly after the president gave his late night speech on May the 1st. And there was a crowd outside the White House, and they couldn't see us, but as we departed, they were chanting, CIA, CIA, CIA. I turned to the boss and said, sir, I don't know if we should smile or run. So that's not something you normally hear and embrace as a CIA officer. What I'd like to impart today is a little bit of some brief words on our philosophy behind engagement with the press and a little bit of the anatomy of the relationship between people like me who serve in national security media relations roles and reporters. Our philosophy is quite simple, and this is probably intuitive to all of you, but let me just lay it out there anyway. Number one, is that we do believe that even though we're a secret intelligence agency, we have a responsibility to the American people and to inform them. Secondly, we obviously defend the agency's equities, its mission, and its men and women. And third, especially at CIA, but not exclusively at CIA, we believe it's our responsibility to defend sources and methods. And that's really where our engagement with the press sometimes becomes dicey. Let me talk a little bit about leaks. Reporters call it source information. On this side of the room, we tend to call them leaks or unauthorized disclosures. I often say that I'm on the front lines of leak awareness, which is true. And having grown up in this town, I've become, pretty much resigned to the reality that leaks are going to happen. So at CIA, we believe that it's important that we have robust engagement with the press. We have a healthy respect for the role that the press has in our society. And we believe that it's critical that we develop relationships with our counterparts in order to inform. It's not in anyone's interest to have bad information out there. And of course, it's important to defend information that perhaps shouldn't be in the public domain. When it comes to leaks, I often tell the story. I still get asked about the assassination of President Kennedy and whether or not the CIA had a role in it. And, I have a standard line for that, ridiculous, wrong, absurd, false. And so, as a result, I've gained a certain reputation for venomous quotes. But, I often tell people who ask me that question, look, it's been nearly 50 years, if I'm doing the math correctly. This is Washington. Don't you think it would have leaked by now if the CIA had some kind of role in the assassination of President Kennedy? But let me go back to the original point here, and that's the trifecta, the inform, defend, and then protect sensitive sources and methods. I feel blessed at the CIA to work with professionals who have PhD plus level knowledge on just about every issue in the world. We do cover the globe, and we have deep expertise. And, we do, to the extent we can, without revealing classified information or sources and methods, we do engage with the press to try to inform and shape stories. That's not spin. That's inform. And we take it as really a sacred responsibility in our office to help reporters understand the world as it is. Whether it's Al-Qaeda or counterproliferation issues or counter-narcotics or piracy off the coast of Somalia, we think it's critical that the American public be informed. We can't be a totally opaque secret intelligence agency. We can't be totally transparent either, for obvious reasons, but we can be somewhere in between. And I will say that the cadre of beat reporters who cover CIA and the intelligence community tend to be quite responsible. And as a result, we have good relationships with them. I don't believe that there's an inherently hostile relationship between reporter and public affairs officer. There are disagreements at times, sometimes heated disagreements, but I would encourage all of you to develop a close relationship with public affairs officers at government agencies, because over time that will redound to your benefit, because we do tell reporters when they're going in the wrong direction, and I think that's valued. Reporters' credibility and careers depend on accurate and precise information being reported in their stories. And that guidepost often is set by people like me. Now, when it comes to the more difficult conversations, and for some reason I've had more and more of these over the past 6 months than I've had in the last four or so years in this job, but you know, there, for whatever reason, I have my own hypotheses, but I need to keep some of those thoughts in the inside voice. I have asked for media outlets to strongly consider not reporting certain information or to go a little bit more general in order to protect people or to protect sources and methods. I've won and I've lost on occasion. But that's you know, something that, you know, again, it's important for us to engage, because if my media counterparts don't trust me, then we're not going to be able to have that honest conversation about a particular issue that we deem to be sensitive. And you know, in the aftermath of the very successful post or Bin Laden operation, a lot has come out, and perhaps that's natural. But by the same token, you know, some of what's come out to me has been unfortunate, because you know, we have I think paid a price for a very successful intelligence mission. I'm going to close with just a few other observations. So just reinforce the point: develop that solid relationship with you know, people through the front door, as reporters call it. People in the public affairs offices, because they can be of use. They are not always going to be hostile or adversarial. They do often want to help. A few observations that that I would note, and I'm not quite sure how to attribute these trends, but there does seem to be a little bit more of, and this is getting back to what Frank said earlier, I think there's a lot to cover out there. I really do. There's a lot of beehive ball right now, you know, and I played a lot of it as a young soccer player growing up in Northern Virginia. You know, you kind of chase the ball around. A lot of reporters these days, I seize on the issue du jour, whether it's Al-Qaeda or the relationship with Pakistan, and focus on that. I would encourage greater creativity, to be honest. I think that there's a great deal that really isn't being covered right now. Maybe that's because of trends in the industry, or perhaps it's due to other factors. I would note, too, that at least from my vantage point, I don't know how we grapple with this as a society, but the leaks are becoming, in some cases, more serious and are accelerating. So. That is of concern to me as a public affairs officer, because I do believe that there's a disposition in our society to provide information and to provide sunlight and openness. By the same token, we do have to protect certain information, certain sources and methods to keep us all safe. And in your careers as reporters, when you come across national security information that you know is serious, have that honest, open conversation with people like me. With that, I'm going to turn it back over to Frank, and thank you again for having me.
George, thank you again for being with us and for those thoughts. We'll return to the other side of this policy press conversation with Catherine Herridge, who, if you were tuning into Fox News, you see very frequently, thank goodness. She is one of the serious beat reporters in certainly the broadcast medium, I would say the best, going in some cases, as George says, where nobody else is going because she follows her nose on important stories that need covering. She is also the author of a brand new book, widely celebrated, The New Wave. And Catherine, it's great to have you with your perspective joining us.
Thank you very much, and thank you to the other members of the panel. I'm honored to be here today. Okay, so let me tell you a little bit about me and how I got started in this area. 20 years ago, I was an extremely young radio reporter and working at ABC News in London. And in those days, it was the height of the mainland bombing campaign for the IRA. And that was a campaign which used small explosive devices in shopping malls, garbage cans, pubs. And this was the IRA's way to really sow fear among the British people and get them out of Northern Ireland. And in those early days, I would not realize that 20 years later, I was still following terrorism in the way that I am today. And in those early days, I had the good fortune of meeting, at the time, a guy who was a weapons inspector who eventually went on to Iraq. And he used to always joke to me that Saddam Hussein thought all the weapons inspectors were spies. And then he would joke and say, well, of course we are, if he only knew it. But he said, you know, Catherine, terrorism is like water. It takes the path of least resistance. It's a thinking enemy. And when you move one way, it moves another. And I think no truer words have ever been spoken, at least to me, about what terrorism looks like and how it's constantly evolving. Since my time in England, I traveled, I've been to Iraq, Afghanistan, many points in the Middle East, the former Yugoslavia, and I've seen the same scenarios being used over and over again. It's like the terrorists have a playbook that they all operate out of. And one of the fundamental things they try and do is they try to get you to attack your own belief system and make a lot of changes so that you destroy the system, which is yourself, which is their ultimate goal. I was in New York on 9/11 and then came down to Washington after that. It was going to be for just a short period of time, but it's been a decade and a cat and a husband and two children later, and I am still here. One of the things that I want to emphasize to you today is that, you know, Al-Qaeda has been, for me at least, one of the defining issues of my career, but the Al-Qaeda that I look at today and the U.S. intelligence community looks at today is not the Al-Qaeda of 9/11. Al-Qaeda has become a set of ideas and a movement, and it has evolved. I would argue now there are really at least three threat streams facing the United States. There's that traditional threat stream that we've talked about for many years in Pakistan, also Afghanistan. We've seen cases where Americans have gone overseas to train in these camps and then come back and launch attacks here in the United States. Then you have the emergence of what I call the new threat hubs, which would be these Al-Qaeda affiliates in Yemen and Somalia. And what's been a particular note to me is the way in which Americans have appeared in fairly senior roles in this organization. In Somalia, there's a young man from Daphne, Alabama called Omar Hamami, who has sort of risen through the ranks to become a field commander and the chief propagandist for the organization. In Yemen, there's the American-born cleric Anwar al-Awlaki, who has made this transformation from a propagandist to someone who is an operational planner. And people who know me, like George, I would say in particular, know that Anwar al-Awlaki really became my reporting obsession about 18 months ago after Fort Hood. You'll remember the accused shooter, Major Nidal Hassan, had this peculiar email relationship with Anwar al-Awlaki. I'd like to say Anwar al-Awlaki is part of Al-Qaeda 2.0, or this new generation of American recruits, or what I call in my book the next wave. These are people who really use our technology against us, whether it's email, Skype, YouTube. He's kind of the Facebook friend from hell, because what he's able to do is to make that connection to people that traditionally we thought you had to make in person. You know, for a long time, members of the U.S. intelligence community have told me that it was the mentoring thing. You know, you had to have personal contact to help someone cross that threshold to violence. But that seems to be less and less the case. People seem to be able to cross that threshold in a more virtual way than they did before. I'm not saying that that's the norm, but it seems to be happening more and more so. And I think Fort Hood was kind of a case in point. And then finally, we have this phenomenon of what people like to call homegrown terrorism. These are people right here in the United States who eventually go on to try and launch attacks inside the United States, and not without any, not without direction from, we'll say, Al-Qaeda proper, or from these affiliates. And when I've taken on this reporting, I always ask myself, in terms of the information that I use, is this really a national security issue, or is this kind of a cover your you know what issue? Because there's a lot of politics that comes into national security reporting. In the particular case of the cleric Anwar al-Awlaki, I would argue that when people have said to me this type of information is classified, I've come to the conclusion that it's classified because a lot of people's political careers are at stake. Not many people realize that in October of 2002, the American-born cleric was held in federal custody here in the United States because there was an active warrant for his arrest, but an FBI agent ordered his release, which is a pretty astounding thing, considering where he is today. And there's never really been clarity on what happened in October of 2002, and I write in my book that based on my reporting, this information was likely withheld from the 9/11 Commission and from Congress. So we have to understand, in my opinion, what the facts are on the ground in order to avoid the same mistakes in the future. You know, in a lot of ways, I'm very envious of all of you because the technology has never been better than what it is today. But I'm also a little nervous for you because I think the temptation is to try and report remotely, to never go to these places, to never talk to these people in person. Because let me tell you, when you're a national security reporter, you're like a human intelligence officer. I can't tell you, and I think my colleagues would agree, how much information you pick up when you go places and you talk to people in person. And I just want to tell you a short story to wrap up, which I think will illustrate the power of that kind of reporting. And I would really encourage you that if you pursue national security reporting, that you really take this to heart. I spent a fair amount of time reporting at Guantanamo Bay, and I've been in the courtroom down there with the 9/11 suspects. The courtroom's maybe about the size of this room, and there's a very small section kind of where we are in the back, which is glassed off. And then on the far front left-hand side of the courtroom, there are five defense tables for each of the 9/11 suspects. And in the summer of 2009, the Obama administration was reassessing what they would do with the 9/11 case. And there were some occasional hearings at the military commissions for the 9/11 suspects, but they were really just procedural hearings. But I always insisted on going because every chance you had to see these people, something always happened. And on this occasion, we were transferring from an open session to a classified session. And a guy, Waleed bin Attash, he is not a household name, but he's really like Al-Qaeda royalty. His family and Osama bin Laden's families were friends. He was in the court and I saw him and he took this legal pad in front of him and he made this paper airplane. And he shot it at one of his co-conspirators, a guy called Baluchi, who is not a household name, but he's a nephew of Khalid Sheikh Mohammed, the self-described architect of 9/11. And I saw this happen. And I saw these two guys laughing, like really hard. And I couldn't hear them because the military controls the sound, but I could see what was going on. And I thought, I gotta find out what's up with that. And what I learned later from one of the lawyers who was there that day is that when the guards retrieved the paper airplane from the table inside the plane, Bin Attash had written either the flight numbers for 9/11 or the tail numbers for the jets. And so the image of that courtroom and the two 9/11 suspects, 7 years, 8 years after the plot, mocking us with the flight numbers in that jet, that was a real window into the darkness of who these people are. And the only way that you can convey and report information like that is if you go in person and see it for yourself. And I would really encourage you, as you begin your careers, not to overuse the technology and to do everything remotely. Because you've got to see these things for yourself and you've got to feel them for yourself to really communicate that to your readers. And I tell that story to people because, you know what, that's not a classified information type of story. But you may learn more about the 9/11 suspects from that story than you may read in hundreds of pages of print, because it tells you who they are. And the final point I want to make, which picks up on the excellent speech that George gave, is that in this business, I think especially in national security, you only really have two things at the end of the day. And one of that is your reputation, right? I mean, people get to know you over the years. It's a small community. And you want to be able to stand behind your work to the extent that you can. And the only other thing you're ever going to have are your relationships and your contacts. And you have to see that these are relationships that you have to build up over many, many years with people. I've done some reporting on the cleric recently, which took me back to a contact that I first met at the Moussaoui trial in the Eastern District of Virginia, who helped me unlock how the cleric, who's now the first American on the CIA's killer capture list, managed to slip through the FBI's grasp after 9/11. Someone I've known for 9 years. 9 years. So your reputation and your contacts, and there's nothing, in my opinion, that replaces, you know, boots on the ground reporting.
Catherine, thank you. Thank you for your boots on the ground reporting and for the admonition how important it is. Speaking of boots on the ground, one of the things that I'm particularly seized with at the moment as a real concern is something that our next speaker, Brian Kelley, has spent an entire career doing, and that is trying to defeat people who are seeking to gain access to our classified information or our agencies for the purposes of doing us harm. His background in counterintelligence, both as a practitioner and as a trainer in both the Air Force and the CIA, is the stuff of legend, and it is great to have you with us to shed some insights into how you view these challenging issues.
Thank you very much, Frank. First of all, congratulations to all of you who are sitting out there. As Frank mentioned, I am a trainer. I teach at several graduate schools year-round, and I see a lot of people your age. And I know firsthand how difficult it is to come to Washington or other areas and to give up a lot. You're giving up an awful lot to begin your journey into a field that is really exciting. We talked about this before we came downstairs here. Brand new field in national security, and you're going to be able to get advanced degrees, and hopefully you will. I know some of the people are from one of the schools I teach at are here today, advanced degrees in some of this stuff. And nothing is better, I can tell you, from a professor, I have a dual role here, than getting an internal memo or an email or a letter from one of my students saying, "Professor Kelley, guess what? I just got my clearance, or I just got this job, and now I'm inside the system." And we love to teach you because you really care, and it's a real pleasure to see so many of you out there. I've been in other classrooms where the dress code is a little different. Men's hairstyles a little different. We like to see this out there that you really care and you bring a lot into the classroom, and we really enjoy teaching you. I'm going to pick up a point from my colleagues over here. I'm a case officer, been a case officer for the better part of 4 decades, served a lot overseas, so I've had a lot of practitioner type experience. But we're both in the area of going after sources. I'm going to try to distinguish how different from the core collector, the case officer, perspective, and a lot of the similarities you're going to see between what I do for a living, or anybody trained like me, and what my colleagues in the press do. We're out there trained, after we get through all this, the system, we finally get into a place like CIA, or the Department of Defense, or the FBI, and we're out there trained, and trained for a long period of time. It could be a couple of years before we actually go out into the field. My job, or any person trained like me, is to collect secret information by secret means. Have any of you ever met a CIA case officer before? Okay. And you're still alive? I want to make sure, okay. But we're out there undercover. You're out there as a press. They've got press credentials. We don't have CIA credentials walking our way through. We're out there looking for people who have access to secrets or protected information. We're trained to do that. We're trained to spot them, see who they are, to assess them, to see if we can perhaps recruit them. We're vetting them to make sure that they do have the access and they're the type of person we want to try and recruit Then we actually do the recruitment and then the handling. That's where we start to collect the information. We have to make sure all the way along the line that this person that we believe has access to the secrets and actually does is not a fabricator. Some of my students read a book called Curveball. Some of you heard it by another colleague of mine from the LA Times, Bob Drogan. Extraordinarily excellent book about how we were had by a fabricator, and did this in fact lead us into the most recent war. So that person is a fabricator. Is he a double agent? In other words, pretending to be on our side, but in fact working for another service. I've done that from this side a lot of part of my career, is to put double agents in front of an adversary. Have the adversary try and recruit them, but we're in fact manipulating. CIA lost several in a very tragic situation last year in a place called Coast, where we lost several of our colleagues because a double agent run by the terrorists of Al-Qaeda blew himself up, a medical doctor blew himself up and took the lives of several very brave CIA officers. So we've got to make sure they're not double agents. We've got to make sure that these people are not people that are mentally unbalanced. We get some of those, and I'm sure my colleagues over here have run into a few of those along the way. It seems really good at the beginning, and because you have things like the internet, you can put together a pretty good story along the way. So we have to make sure these. When we do enter this relationship, we have a contract with them. The most part, people are out there because they need money. So we will often it's a contract of we'll pay you a salary with bonuses. It may also be something along the lines of my elderly mother needs some medical assistance. Can you get a doctor? Can we send her to the United States for help? Can I get my kid in a scholarship to the United States? Can I at some point jump to the United States with my family and resettle? So we have these agreements. And the reason we get better sources than they do is because we pay better. Okay, we can offer these things that you can't do. So there's a different set of rules as we play along the way, but we are all in the business of acquiring information, the degree of secrecy, because when I'm in the what they call the pointy edge of the spear, I'm out in the front, we're the boots on the ground. Catherine talked about being in the courtroom. There is no substitute for being there and to talk to your asset. We call them assets or agents, primarily assets, that somebody we recruited or we're handling and provides us information. The downside of these people, if they get caught working with CIA, loss of a job, they could go to jail, and they could suffer the ultimate, which is execution. This is a very serious business. I want you to think back just the last couple of days ago when we heard for the first time in the news that Pakistan has arrested, the number is 567, former CIA assets that assisted the CIA in the bin Laden issue, including a medical doctor, what we call a safe housekeeper, somebody who provided places where CIA operatives could hide and watch the compound. How quick did that happen? We had a discussion last night in another class I was doing about, did the Pakistanis really know that this guy was living right in the midst of all where they're doing? They claim no, and yet they claim the other side, well, we were assisted CIA, tell them about that compound. How quick after Osama bin Laden's death did they arrest half a dozen people? What does that tell you? You just don't do this willy-nilly. We have to protect these people. We have to protect our sources. It's very important. Now, how do we get sources? Much the same way of our colleagues over here. People approach us. They come to us because they have a story to sell. They have something they want to get out there. We go and we get a lot of volunteers. Most of the important spies in history were, in fact, volunteers. Traitors on our side, Ames and Hansen. I can go a long list of Soviets, Chinese, Cubans, have come to us because they want to work with us for whatever reason, whatever motivation. We are also trained to acquire. You're going to be doing this a lot in some of your classes. How then do you get someone that you are targeting who has access to the information you want to report on? How do you get that? So we are trained in the clandestine arts and how to elicit, to get these people across the line. We can do it straight out. We're a CIA officer. We'd like to have you work with us. We can do it something called a false flag. This has worked very, very well, where we come at you from a different perspective. We're not Americans. We're not CIA. We're, in fact, from Israel. We're from Canada, whatever it's going to work for us. So this is how we get people to come in and to work with us. At all times, we're constantly checking. Catherine mentioned this. You've got to make sure that the information that they're reporting to you is valid. Why? Because if I'm a case officer, I've got to see Director Woolsey at some point. He's going to want to know, how do you know this information is accurate? I'm going over to President of the United States. We have to validate constantly what we call asset validation. And finally, protection of sources. We all like to protect our sources. We need to protect our sources. I worked with a trader by the name of Rick Ames. Some of you may remember him. Rick Ames had access to virtually all of the intelligence information we had against the Soviet Union during the height of the Cold War. Ames volunteers in April of 1985. He's arrested on the 21st of April in 21st of February in 1994. During that almost 9 years' time, he gave up everything we had against the Soviet target during the Cold War, but we didn't know it. All the operations that CIA was running. At the same time, we didn't even know it. The FBI has a mole in their midst by the name of Bob Hansen, another person I worked very closely with. He gave up everything the FBI had in three periods of espionage, starting in late 1979 until his arrest on the 18th of February 2001. The United States was vulnerable, and we never knew it because the information was flowing out the back door through two traitors, two extremely well-placed traitors, two of the worst traitors, you can argue, in U.S. history, leaving our country and our nation very vulnerable in the height of the Cold War. We've talked about WikiLeaks. We talked about things that also get out into the press. These do irreparable damage to our protection of sources. Counterintelligence has an offensive and defensive side of it. I've talked to you about the offensive side. We go after them for double agents. I've played the game of deception throughout my career, tried to deceive the other side. Lots and lots of stories over the years. But from the defensive side, we are trying to ferret out the moles in our own system. We're trying to figure out, how do we lose this? When something hits the press, or the other side learns about it, these are protected information, and all of a sudden it becomes public. Then you start doing a damage assessment, but you start looking, how do they find out? My job as a counterespionage investigator is to take a look at it. What I may be lacking is one small piece which one of your sources, which gets in the press, might be able to give me. From that, I'm able to go, therefore, and find that particular mole. So it's very, very important to us that responsible journalists, and I've worked with several of the people here, George has worked in his career, they come and they talk. A lot of things get capped. A lot of things get spiked because we say, if you report that, somebody's going to die. The worst thing that a case officer can do is to lose his or her asset. We have to live with the fact that one of our people that we've worked very closely with that have taken enormous risks, not necessarily for the money. Often these people are driven in other ways. We bond with them. Then all of a sudden, we learn that that person's been arrested and executed. Until we find out who did it, we have to live with the fact maybe it was something we did that caused that person to die. So the responsibility of the press is very critical. Dr. Little's role is very critical. There's a relationship back and forth. Leave that open for your discussion later on.
Thank you so much. Brian, it's again, this kind of firsthand experience that I think lends real authority to what we're talking about today. Finally, speaking of real-world experience, few reporters have operated at the high level that our next and final speaker, Jamie McIntyre, has for longer. Covering the Pentagon for 16 years before leaving in 2009, I believe, and now blogging for military.com. But his visage was very familiar to those of us who worked in the building and those of you who were, or your parents who were covering, watching, trying to learn about all manner of issues that were taking place, the various wars and counterterrorism operations and so on. And Jamie's superb at it, and we're delighted to have you with us to shed some insights on your part.
Hi, I'm Jamie McIntyre. Perhaps you remember me from television when I was compromising U.S. military missions and jeopardizing the lives of U.S. troops. I kid, I'm kidding. Anybody tweeting, I don't want you to tweet, it's a joke. But as my mom used to say, you know, many a truth is said in jest. And covering the Pentagon is an amazing place because, I don't know if you know this, but the Pentagon is unlike any other military headquarters in the world because the Pentagon allows reporters to have offices inside the building. And then they give us passes that we are allowed to walk pretty much anywhere in the building. The Pentagon has 17 and a half miles of corridor, and almost all of it is open to news reporters. So we can, as I like to I was struck when you said, you know, you operate almost as a human intelligence agent at the Pentagon. What we were doing would be called spying if we weren't reporters, because actually what we do is we get up every day, wander around these 17 and a half miles of corridor, try to find out secret stuff, and then blab it to everybody. That was essentially my job. So the question, you know, there's two parts to what we're talking about today. A lot of it has focused on how we get information and what kind of information we get. And I'd like to mention a little bit about the responsibility of what you do with that information when you get it. How many of you think, by the way, that the government has a right to keep secrets? How many of you have a think the government has a right to keep secrets? Show of hands. All right, well, that would separate you from, say, Julian Assange. And I don't mean to demonize Julian Assange, but one of the key differences between what he does and what, say, Bill Gertz does, or Catherine does, is, as you heard Bill say, when they get information, he evaluates it. He decides, is it newsworthy? Is it important? Is it accurate? Should it be reported? And they make he makes a judgment about that. Julian Assange and WikiLeaks is completely indiscriminate. You know, people have called WikiLeaks, you often hear it referred to as a whistleblower organization. It's not a whistleblower organization. Whistleblowers are people who want to uncover wrongdoing in the government or malfeasance or other things. WikiLeaks is interested in covering wrongdoing and rightdoing and all kinds of doings. Without regard to whether it's whether there's context or it's whether it's accurate or whether it's helpful or whether it advances U.S. policy goals or hurts U.S. policy goals or even gets anybody killed. And so far we don't know of anybody been killed because of WikiLeaks releases, but we don't know what we don't know. So, you know, but as a reporter, when you're covering this, and you know the government is keeping secrets, and by the way, there's a, you know, a really, you were talking about terrific books, there's a really terrific book called Necessary Secrets. I'm sorry, the author escapes me at the moment, but it was Gabriel Schoenfeld, right. Excellent book, should probably be read by anybody covering national security because it's a really textured look at when should the government keep secrets and what should reporters do in terms of uncovering them. So why does the government keep things secret? Well, one reason that reporters are really interested in is because a lot of times they've screwed things up. You know, there's waste, fraud, abuse, mismanagement, just plain stupidity, bad decisions, all of that stuff the government would just rather not be reported in the press. And that's one of the legitimate roles of the press, is to hold the government accountable for those kinds of things. The other reason, of course, that the government wants to keep things secret is because some things are better done in private. You know, when the WikiLeaks came out and it revealed shockingly that that while we were saying positive things about the Pakistani government, we secretly suspected, or privately suspected, because it really wasn't a secret, privately suspected that they were doing all sorts of things to undermine what we were doing, and in fact, that the Pakistani intelligence services were doing all kinds of unhelpful things. Well, to anyone who's covering, this came as no shock to, you know, Catherine or Stephen or Bill. Anybody who'd been following this knew this. But what it underscores is that in order for us to conduct policy and try to advance our goals, a lot of times the U.S. government has to do things in private. Imagine if every interaction you had with somebody had to be public, every private email, everything you ever said bad about your boss or your teacher or anybody had to be conducted in private. In public, it would make it much harder just in the basic course of human events. So there's that. But there's another reason, too, that the government wants to keep things secret. And to paraphrase Jack Nicholson in A Few Good Men, it's because the media can't handle the truth sometimes. I mean, they just can't handle the context. And the highest, you know, one of the things that the media needs to do is they need to hold government accountable. The other thing that I would say one of the highest core responsibilities of the news media in general is to provide context and understanding to the events. We are in a wash of information. You know, this is the best of times and the worst of times in the information age. We have more information. We actually even have more context. But it's completely drowned out in this sort of sea of information. And trying to figure out what you should believe and how you should believe it and what are the actual real facts of a debate, it's increasingly difficult. And one of the unfortunate byproducts products of this great information revolution that we're living in is that it's resulted in a tabloidization of a lot of the news media, including some of the all-news cable networks like the one I used to work for, which has discovered that a very successful business model isn't necessarily based on contextual, nuanced reporting. It's the difference, as I like to say, between informing public opinion and inflaming public opinion. And increasingly, the news media, particularly media, you know, when CNN started in 1980, it was really the only global all-news television network. If you wanted to find out what was going on during the course of the day, you know, before until your newspaper came out or the network news came on at 6:30, you could listen to radio. There was some radio newscasts where you could find out what was going on. Or you could watch CNN, which was on 24 hours a day. It was really the only place to get to find out what was happening. Today, of course, it's not the case at all. You can be very aware of everything that's happening as it's happening without ever watching CNN. So CNN has to figure out, well, what is it going to do to attract viewers if you no longer need it? And one of the ways they do it is they continue to look for things that are going to provoke outrage. They're more interested in stories that are going to provoke outrage, and they're more interested in portraying stories, controversial stories, in a way that reduces them to a caricature and then, you know, gets and portrays them in the worst possible way. And that's the environment that a lot of reporters are working in. One of the real challenges that you'll have if you become a reporter in the national security field, and Catherine touched on this a little bit, at the end of the day, what do you really have? Your reputation. And what is your reputation based on? It's based on your track record of accuracy and whether you're a reporter who does, in fact, do the essential role of journalism, which is to bring facts to bear on a story, provide the context, and help people understand what is the real debate that we're having. And I would just say that generally what you find in the field is you find two different kinds of reporters. You find either you're seen, let me put it this way, the most difficult challenge you have is to enjoy the respect of the people that you cover and the respect of the people that you work for. Because generally you fall into one of two categories. Either your editors think you're terrific, you're aggressive, you're out there digging out the truth, holding the government accountable, but these guys over here think you're an arrogant, agenda-driven asshole. Or the opposite is the case. You know, George Little thinks that you're a great reporter who's careful and keeps the facts in perspective, provides, you know, alternate explanations of things, you know, is conservative with a small c in terms of sticking to what the facts actually show and not speculating. He thinks you're doing a great job, and your boss thinks you're too willing to accept what the government says, you're not aggressive enough, and by the way, they like that other person's story much better. So when Frank says that Bill Gertz is one of the most respected in the industry, it's because he's been able to walk that line that so few reporters are able to do, where he enjoys tremendous respect from the people that he covers and tremendous respect from the people that he works for and, by the way, who he competes against. I don't mean to slight anybody else here, but I'm just citing Bill because I've known him for so long. I'm sure Catherine has the same situation, I can tell from the comments over here. And that is not going to make you the most popular reporter in town. It's not going to make you the most famous reporter. It's not going to make you the most desired or the highest paid reporter in town. But at the end of the day, what do you have is your reputation, and be able to go home at the end of the day and look yourself in the mirror and say, you know, I really provided an important and valuable service in what I did. And I would leave it there.
Okay. We're going to move that around. We took a little longer than we had actually budgeted for these conversations, but I think it was important to do it, to give you some of the context, to give you some of the stories, to give you some of the personal struggles that individuals have had to deal with professionally on both sides of this account. So with that, let me open it up to your questions. We're going to ask you to use the mic so that we can get you heard on the recording, and then we're going to get the mic back and allow somebody to respond to it. If you have somebody in particular, oh, we got two mics. Hallelujah. Great. All right. So forget that point. If you have somebody you'd specifically like to address your question to, do so. If not, I'll see if I can elicit a volunteer. Anybody have a question? Yes, sir.
It's been said that, I think by several people, that since 9/11, the increase in your recruiting has gone up. It kind of goes in cycles based on the Cold War, then, you know, kind of a lull and then back up. As talking to a young person, I'm an undergraduate, what can you say, you know, when we're choosing a career in foreign policy, national security, we've got think tanks, we've got the Hill, we've got reporting, we've got, you know, your organization. What do we have, you know, when we have a leak, it's almost like a negative connotation. How can you answer that in terms of how can we put a spin on, not a spin per se, but a positive impact on the nation when reporters are constantly leaking information that puts a negative spin on the agency?
Oh, that sounds like one for you, George, for sure.
A couple of points, I guess, on that. You know, the agency has continued to hire. Last year, we received over 180,000 job applications. I think that's a record. And when a new CIA movie comes out, the applications tend to spike. So there, remains a strong interest in joining America as a premier foreign intelligence agency. It is a tremendously rewarding career. I could speak about CIA, but of course the intelligence community writ large has some outstanding opportunities. But within CIA itself, there are 90 different job occupations. You can have many careers within, one agency over, 30, 35 years. So that's one thing to bear in mind. I'd like to massage a little bit of what you said on leaks. There's really a third table missing here, and that's the leakers. It's not reporters who leak. It's someone else who provides reporters information. And as I said earlier, my perception is that the leaking, has always been there in Washington, but it's gotten steadily worse over the last several years, and I'm not quite sure why. One thing that I would note in the intelligence community is that it's very hard sometimes for reporters to develop sources. Okay, that's for obvious reasons. Sometimes you don't really know who works for the intelligence community. And sometimes there's over-reliance on former intelligence officials for insights into the current activities of the CIA and other intelligence agencies. And if you pursue a career in reporting, I would ask that you, cast a very wide net to make sure that what the formers are saying tracks with what's actually happening. In some cases, you have retired officers from, the late 1990s who are out there in public talking about CIA morale in 2011. And to me, that doesn't make a whole lot of sense. I mean, Bill Gertz can talk about what morale was like at the Washington Times, back then. But, our former officers can't, who left the agency pre-9/11. And 60% of our workforce, or thereabouts, has joined since 9/11. So it's a totally different agency. I'll leave it at that. Brian, maybe you have some thoughts, too.
I would also like to echo that. You read people that are disaffected in some way or another. George's point is very, very critical. There are people out there who are saying things. They haven't been inside the building 10, 15, 20 years. And I have a friend who has a friend, that sort of thing. Keep in mind also 180,000 applications that arrived at CIA. How can we possibly start sifting through all those? Spikes come up as a result of interesting movies. We are not James Bond. You never see Bond with a... Yeah, I said, yes. I hate it when he says that to me. So many women, so little time. That's another story. I don't ever get that. No, but seriously, we do a lot of things sitting behind a desk, with the fingers on a keyboard. The number of jobs you could have just within CIA. I've had a career in the Department of Defense. I've had a career at CIA, career someone in academia. There are so many different things you can do. I just got, very briefly, I just got an email last night from an individual I've been mentoring for over a year. He started out and spent most of his young life in the middle of Africa. He was born and raised in an African country. His government thought very highly of him. They sent him to China to study as a graduate school. He eventually comes to the United States, and he has a master's degree in the United States from a very prestigious school. And then he came to take one of my graduate courses, and I've been mentoring for the last year. He sent me an email the other day and said, I'm finally getting the job that I'm really interested in. It's not exactly what I want, but it gets your foot in the door. My thing to any of you, if you have a job somewhere, it may not be your dream job. If it gets your foot in the door, take it, because you can slide sideways very easily. And I can tell you, don't listen to people who have been out of the business for 10 to 15 years and figure that's the morale of the building. They don't know if they haven't been in it, okay?
Next question. Yes, sir.
Thank you all for your time. I appreciate it. I'm really curious, you talked about Sharia and extremism, combating that. And obviously, we've had a lot of successes recently on the intelligence and military front against extremism and against Al-Qaeda. But it seems to me the most important battlefront is on the narrative side, the combating the ideology. And that seems like something that both journalists and the intelligence community play an important role is. And so I'm curious from both sides of the aisle here, how the intelligence community and journalists can cooperate and create an effective narrative that actually combats the ideology of Al-Qaeda.
Catherine, I wanted to start with you.
thank you very much for the question. You know, I would argue that we still, and I'm using the we in the big sense of the U.S., have a long way to go in terms of understanding the narrative and creating what I would call a counter-narrative. I've talked with people in the last few months. I did a panel at the Aspen Institute where there were groups who were getting on these websites, and they were saying to people, you know, Anwar al-Awlaki says this, but in fact he is not a good scholar. He doesn't understand our religion or what we're trying to do. Anyway, I think the counter-narrative is very important. I really believe that there is a place for journalists and the intelligence community to work together. You know, one of my pet peeves in the last year has been the fact that this cleric in Yemen, who is now public enemy number one, when he lived here in the United States, he had a very shady background. He was picked up several times for soliciting prostitutes and also for loitering around a school in San Diego. And there's several mugshots associated with all of these incidents. And I can't tell you how many people I've questioned about why the U.S. government doesn't make more effective use of these pictures and his background, because it seems like a natural way to discredit them. I can't really say that I've ever gotten a really great answer to that question, except one person did tell me that they thought I was doing a fine job on my own doing this. Now, I'm only one person, but I like to put that information out there because I feel that it tells you a lot about him. And for those who may be considering his message, I think in some cases it may be enough to turn them off or give them another insight into him. But I think the counter narrative is extremely important because, as I mentioned earlier, you know, what I see in my reporting is that it's really become a movement and a set of ideas, and you can't nuke that, right? It doesn't work.
Before we pass the mic on to the other side, just staying here for 1 second, Stephen, you said something that I think bears on this, and that is, and Catherine sort of suggested in her response, that you see yourself as an American first, working for the team. How common is that, how unusual is that in the journalistic trade, where we see many reporters, at least in my experience, feel, at least it appears, that their job is to kind of make these guys look bad, or at least make clear that they're not with them. So would either you or Jamie or Bill want to comment on
well,
that?
Well, it's a good question. I don't know, actually. I'm going to be interested in your thoughts. I don't know how widespread that view is. And there are certainly reporters who don't do the kinds of things that I do. I mean, I have a little bit of a different role now. I mean, I was sort of a national security beat reporter for much of the last decade, and I'm back to covering politics and you know, talking more on Fox and providing context, although I still spend as much time as I can doing the kind of reporting that Catherine and Jamie and Bill were talking about. For me, it's not something I grappled with. I don't spend a lot of time thinking about whether it's right or whether it's wrong that I see, you know, what the United States has done as largely good over two centuries, and I'm unapologetic about it. Other reporters come to these issues with different backgrounds and with different experiences. Somebody who is a national security beat writer for Reuters, for instance, is would not, you know, A, may not be an American, and B, certainly wouldn't see themselves as somebody who's telling America's story. All of that said, that does not mean I don't question aggressively the things that, you know, either the U.S. government or government officials or what have you say and do, and, you know, at times that gets me in trouble for doing that. But I think there's a role to play for a reporter who's both sees myself in that context and also challenges as often as I can and as aggressively as I can.
Do either of you guys want to talk?
Yeah, well, so, you know, I covered the U.S. military for 16 years, wars from beginning with Somalia, the intervention in Somalia through the latest Iraq war. I missed the Libyan one, sorry. And I just want to make a public confession right now that I was rooting for the U.S. the whole time. Every one of those wars. But the reality is that I don't look at my story reporting as from an American patriotic perspective. I just look at it as I try to approach it as a neutral third party. Yes, I'm predisposed. Well, let's just say, I want to believe the best about America. My experience has shown me over the years of reporting that often America falls way short of my personal expectations. So as a reporter, I'm somewhat skeptical. I try not to lapse into cynicism. And generally, my personal patriotic feelings and wanting the United States to be the best America it can be doesn't enter into my reporting at all. I can, however, I've never been in this situation, but I can imagine situations, and I've thought about this as someone who covered the military, where that would come into play. If, for instance, I'm in the field with U.S. troops, and I know I have come into, or even if I'm not in the field, if I come into information about, say, enemy actions that could result in the death of U.S. troops, yes, I'm going to go share that information with the military and try to save American lives, yes. In that case, I will sort of have stepped out of my role as a journalist and sort of stepped into my role as an American citizen, which in some cases I think is going to trump your role as a journalist. And then I think there's also sort of a step beyond that, which is that basically you're a human being relating to other human beings. And I can also imagine a case where I would be setting aside my parochial American patriotism just to act as a human being in a situation where maybe compassion or something is required. These are, for me, theoretical questions because I've never actually faced it. I've never had to be in a situation where I had to weigh my journalistic objectivity against my patriotism or love of my country. But I've thought about it, I thought about what I would do in those situations, and I've decided that there may be cases where I would just have to stop being a journalist and just be an American, or stop being, you know, looking at it from just an American perspective and just be a human being. And I think you just want to think about that ahead of time so you sort of know when the right time is to make that decision.
Thank you, Jamie.
Before we give it up to that side, let me just quickly add to on the ideological war against terrorism, I think that's really the key. If you ask anybody in the military today if we can win the war against terrorism by killing all the terrorists, they're the first to tell you no, because it's an ideological war. You have to use ideological means. And secular governments have a difficult time dealing with semi-religious problems. That's part of the problem. As for cooperation with the government, I'm very wary. I think the arm's length distance has to be kept. That said, there was a model back in the 80s which was controversial and very effective. I believe it was USIA, the US Information Agency, set up a counter-disinformation program to counter Soviet and KGB propaganda, things about the US government doing the AIDS virus, creating the AIDS virus and spreading it in the third world. They were able to, at an arm's length distance, counter some of those false and disinformation operations. So there could be something like that that could be used in the war against terrorism.
Anybody on this side? Jim?
On the ideology point, the narrative, as it's said, today in much of the press is that there are really two groups. There's ordinarily regular Muslims, and then there are a limited number of terrorists, and essentially nothing else. The problem is that there is a third group, Islamists who are not violent, who want, as I said earlier, the rules of the caliphate that you would live in to be that homosexuals are to be killed, that apostates are to be killed, and so on and so on. Some of the, this is all in Frank's book, but some of the most hideous doctrines, such as honor killings. If any of you young ladies here should, in the caliphate that they want to establish, should walk down the street with the boy next door to get an ice cream sundae at the corner drugstore, you would be subject to an honor killing by your father. In many parts of the Muslim world, but certainly not all, but some important parts, females have to undergo genital mutilation. Well, those two very horrible doctrines are not in the Quran. They derive from some 8th and 9th century scholars who came out with some added rules. And they are sometimes adopted in certain countries, but not in others. Also, in the Muslim world, there are wonderful people, such as my late acquaintance, I didn't know him well enough to call him a friend, Abdurrahman Wahid, the former president of Indonesia. Abdurrahman Wahid put together an organization that still exists called Lib for All, Religious Liberty for All. He would travel around Indonesia with Indonesia's leading young rock star, who also believed in religious liberty, and they would put on concerts for young people and talk about the importance of religious liberty. It's hard to be more in favor of religious liberty than Abdurrahman Wahid, unless you're Thomas Jefferson. He was a remarkable man and a devout Muslim. So we have to help people understand that there are indeed terrorists, there are indeed wonderful, perfectly reasonable Muslims, or members of America, many of them in the United States, as well as other places, but there is a group of Islamists that support doctrines that most Americans would believe are entirely alien from our way of life and anything we want to have to do with it. And that clarity is very important, because much of the press, present company excepted, and much of the narrative that is out there ignores that nonviolent but nonetheless caliphate-supporting group of Muslims.
George, do you or Brian want to say anything about collaboration with the press, other than what you've already said? If not, let's take another question. Yes, ma'am. Is there anybody? I want to come over to here, but we'll take you, and then we'll come over here. You're on. Give that young lady the mic. Thank you.
My question is for Mr. Little. You touched a bit earlier on conspiracy theories, like the Kennedy thing, and I just know when Osama was killed at my school, I had a couple of cuckoo friends who just had these crazy theories, and I was just wondering how often you get confronted with that, and what you kind of do to combat it besides just like dismiss it as off the wall.
And do you really manage
the
alien abductions?
Yeah. Yes. And is Osama hiding in the White House?
I'm here to reveal a stunning. yeah, no, it's a very tough it's a very tough thing, to be honest with you. I think that you know, there are conspiracy theorists out there, to be sure, whether it's on Bin Laden or 9/11 itself or other events, you know, in past history. And I think the only way that I know to combat it is to, you know, work with my friends on the journalism side to actually get out what the facts truly are. And that's really the only, you know, way that I know how to, besides, you know, calling something absurd or ludicrous, putting out the information, you know, within reasonable boundaries on what actually happened, I think is the only way to get beyond. It's a simple answer, probably an obvious one, but it's the only one I know, you know, to adopt in my work.
Okay, over here.
Oh, I'm sorry. Just hand you down. I want to say something quick.
I just wanted to say I find the phenomena really interesting. The how the growth of the number of people who believe in various conspiracy theories, and the predisposition of people to believe, well, you know, why smart people believe stupid things. I'm sure some of your friends who had some theories were not stupid people, but they sometimes believe stupid things. It's it's an increasingly a phenomenon, and one of the things that I would say is that facts don't have any bearing on it. There's, you know, I've been personally involved in this one particular conspiracy theory about the people who don't believe a plane hit the Pentagon September 11th. And I have over the year, you know, first I ignored them, and then over the years I've confronted them, and then I've sort of explained them, and I have yet to change the mind of a single person who doesn't believe a plane hit the Pentagon on September 11th. And part of this, and you can, I actually wrote about this on my blog, and if you were actually interested, you go see it, but part of it what happened was, and this is how things work on the internet, and part of it is because people are predisposed to believe the worst about the government, and why do they believe that? Because sometimes the government does really, you know, terrible, nefarious things. So obviously all conspiracy theories are logical. And by the way, what George said is exactly what he would say if the conspiracy theories were true, so we can't believe, you just dismiss that. But what happened to me, I'll make this really brief, but what happened to me was...
There goes your reputation, George.
I was on the air September 11th, I was reporting about the plane, and if you Google me, you'll find me say something along the lines of this. I say, from my close-up inspection, I can tell you there's no evidence a plane hit anywhere near the Pentagon. You can find that quote from me on, it's all over YouTube, it's part of the various conspiracy theories. It shows that here's a CNN correspondent at the Pentagon on September 11th, and he says, in his own words, there's no evidence a plane hit anywhere near the Pentagon. Of course, it's taken out of context, like most of these things are on the internet, and if you have no, and here's the problem with most of these conspiracy theories, is they're very convincing in and of themselves, and if you have no outside information to weigh it against, you don't know what to think. But what happened, and I'll wrap this up, was I was doing my report. I had been up to the scene. I had photographed the crash. I had taken pictures of the wreckage. I was describing what happened at the Pentagon. And the anchor on the air, Judy Woodruff, says to me, Jamie, what about these reports we had earlier about a plane crashing nearby, short of the Pentagon? What about that? And I said, well, Judy, I can tell you from my close-up inspection, there's no sign a plane crashed anywhere near the Pentagon. The only crash site is right behind me here at the Pentagon.
In it.
Just a little
context.
Little context.
All right, sir. Right over here. Oh. Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Hi. My question was for Ms. Herridge. You, when you were talking about your experience in covering terrorism around the world, you said that you noticed kind of a widespread tactic of turning a country against itself. And I kind of noticed that a lot kind of in, like we said, in these narratives about whether it's about Islam and how we should handle those difficult topics and talking about the ideologies and this and that. I was kind of just wondering if you could maybe offer another example of, in your experience around the world, a similar situation that developed in another country.
You know, my experience, unfortunately, over the last two decades is that they all seem to operate from the same playbook, more or less. And if I was going to give you another example, it was just about the time of the Good Friday Peace Agreement in the 90s, and there was a massive car bomb in a place called Omagh, Northern Ireland. And I went up there to cover that, and Omagh is a market town, and the bombing took place in, it was either late July or early August, just before school was starting. And at that time, when the bomb went off, there were a lot of women and young children who were down in the market street buying uniforms for school. And as was typical, it was an IRA splinter group, but it's all, I'm talking generally, the same sort of tactic. What they had done is that they had called in information that the bomb was at the far end of the street so that the police would then move everyone up towards the town hall, which was in fact where the bomb was planted, so that there would be a greater impact. And we spent several days there, and the sort of image I would leave you with is that we went to an elementary school where it was very routine to have these counseling sessions with these children. And one little girl described how almost not a big place and there are not a lot of ambulances. And her father went down to the street and they started putting bodies in the cars to take them to the hospital. And then their father went down another time and they looked for the arms and the legs that matched the clothing of the people they'd already taken. And the reason I tell that is because, you know, one of the tactics is to take an entire generation and turn it against another generation. So if you can poison the minds of an entire group of children in that part of Northern Ireland against another group, you see, you've had a huge victory, because it's very difficult to erase those feelings and to erase those images. And I've thought a lot about that little girl over the years. She must have been probably seven or eight years old. And, you know, to this day, no one's ever been prosecuted for that attack. but it's also now seen as the attack that probably turned the tide and made people in Northern Ireland really turn against the IRA. So sometimes when they launch these attacks, it works in our favor because they sort of overstep the line. You can make the same argument with 9/11. They really overstepped that line, and then there was hell to pay afterwards.
We're almost out of time. Is there one more question over here? Because I sort of shortchanged you. We'll do you, and then this young lady who I promised the mic to. So we'll do both questions, and then we'll get answers, and then we'll wrap up.
Thank you all very much. Thank you all very much for your time. I'm curious about the line you talked, Mr. Hayes, about how in ethics, it's almost always report the story. When has been an instance, and perhaps from both sides, where the reporter did in fact cross the line, did something irresponsible, and there was some sort of detrimental result from that? When would be an example of that?
Okay, we'll take that one, and then this young lady over here. Just this lady in pink, and we'll get answers to both.
Hi, thank you all for coming to speak to us today. My question is for Chairman Woolsey. What is an event, a national security event, that you would give the press an A-plus on covering, and what is an event that you would give a failing grade, or any specific instance of that? Thank you.
Jim, you want to start with that?
I had both on my watch. Two times we were happily by reporters of substance and patriotism, we were given an advance look at a story they wanted to run. And in two cases, there were mentions of something other than names, dates, places, etc., which ran a serious risk of not just stopping or inconveniencing a CIA source, but getting them killed. Both times, I went to the reporter and his or her editor, just the three of us, sat down and talked through it. Both times, the media outlets involved agreed to pull one or two words in each story, so they was a bit vaguer. And my experience along those lines when I was director was that very positive with respect to the press. The two D minuses I would give were, first of all, on the Ames case. We did a very thorough investigation of what had gone wrong. And one thing we decided was that counterintelligence had been divided up among so many hats that the right hand didn't know what the left hand was doing. So we reorganized some important aspects of that at the CIA. But the other thing was that we had done a very careful study of who had made mistakes that made this, or bad judgments that had helped make this happen. There were four individuals, all were retired. Happened, not surprising. These events happened in 85, 86, and we're now talking about my looking back on them from 94. So we announced that we had sent them letters saying you really fouled up, but nobody was fired. The press could not get it out of its head that no one was fired. I must have been asked dozens of times, why didn't you fire anybody over Ames? Answer, we investigated, the people who were responsible are retired. Got a lot of from the Hill, just fire the first three people through the door. I said, suppose those are the three people, Paul Redmond and Gene Verdafe and Sandy Grimes, the three people who caught Ames. And I get this sort of deer in the headlights look. But the press on that and on one other thing were like what Gene McCarthy used to say about the press, blackbirds on a wire, one fly, all fly. The other one was the construction of a building for the National Reconnaissance Office, the satellite folks. The Senate Intelligence Committee had pushed it hard. They really wanted a building so they could all be pulled together. We got it built. Average cost for Northern Virginia, average occupancy. One, it was revealed that it had been built and that it was really going to be for the NRO. The press got hold of the story that it had cost X million dollars. From Capitol Hill and from every part of the press except Bill, the Washington Times, big, important, extremely expensive building built by CIA, headlines, on and on and on. You say, average cost for Northern Virginia, average occupancy. Yeah, didn't matter. Nobody reported that. Didn't pay attention, except the Times. So on things like that, my experience with the press was as negative as my experience was positive when real national security matters, someone's life was involved. Why are they like that on one thing and not, I don't know.
Anybody on this side want to talk about crossing the line? Stephen, you were sort of specifically said.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure we could all come up with a number of incidents. There were a series of incidents in the 1970s where journalists chose deliberately to publish the names of people whose names should not have been published that resulted in serious complications to missions and lives, what have you. I think maybe just end with another story. You know, the kinds of decisions that you have to make are not often easy and clean decisions. When I was in Iraq before the war, actually in Kuwait before the war, we were staying at this Hilton south of Kuwait City, about 25 kilometers south of Kuwait City. And the war had started. It had been going for a couple days. And I was standing outside on the balcony of, we actually had a villa that I shared with my Weekly Standard colleague because the rooms in the main hotel were all booked. So I was standing outside on the balcony of my villa looking out at the water, and literally over my head came a missile. And it shook our entire building, shook the remote control off of the table in front of the television. And you know, we were sort of stunned. And then moments later, we saw another one that hit in the water just in front of us. And you know, of course, the first thing you want to do is learn everything you can to about the incident. We raced down to try to find out where the impact was, what have you. And then we checked with people both on site and back at the Pentagon to find out what had happened. And the people on site, it was actually the place where everybody who was going forward to Baghdad, once Baghdad fell, the senior leadership of the U.S. military was staying at this hotel complex. And so I went over there to talk to some public affairs folks and asked, so you know, what was that? What do we know about the attack? How close was it? And I got a look, and this person said, "What attack?" And I said, "Well, surely you saw the missile hit right in front of the hotel, and there was another one that sailed over our heads. I mean, that's the one I'm talking about." This person said, "What attack?" And I said, no, seriously. So anyway, I called the Pentagon and I said, "Hey, there was this missile that landed out in front of the hotel. I mean, a number of reporters saw it. What can you tell us? Can you give us any content?" "What missile?" And literally just trying to tell us that this hadn't happened. So then as a reporter, I'm sitting, I know what I saw. We had talked to other journalists who were looking into writing something about the story. We ended up taking a trip. It was about a mile, kilometers south of where we were staying that the other missile had impacted and had blown apart a rug store on a traffic circle. And I mean, it was very obvious to see. And I pressed and pressed and said, "Come on, you gotta be kidding me. You're gonna tell us that this didn't happen. You're not gonna allow us to report this." And finally somebody said, made the obvious case, but it was helpful to hear it, "If we tell you what happened, and if you report the details of what happened, it helps them with their targeting. Now, you can report that, but then it's on you if you decide to do it." Well, it didn't take much convincing at that point to not report the story, or at least to hold it for some period of time, and that's what we ended up doing. So,
particularly because presumably your villa was one of the targets.
presumably, yes.
Don't improve that targeting, folks.
Can I just add one thing? I'm at TV, so I can do this in a minute, 48 seconds.
Okay, or less.
In the late 1990s, the U.S. government was tracking Osama bin Laden through his satellite phone. That was reported. It then took another 10 years to get Osama bin Laden, so bad one for the press. A little bit of thought would have thought maybe that wasn't such a great idea. In the time I was at the Pentagon, you know, we didn't usually run our stories by the Pentagon, but five or six times we had something we thought we needed to check out ahead of time. We went to the Pentagon, we said, here's what we, every case they said, don't report it, it'll harm somebody. In every case, we never promised not to report it, we just said, you know, we'll take your advice, we'll go back and we'll decide what to do. In every case, we decided, and I was very had very supportive management, that we were not going to report it. In every case, we sat on the story while somebody else reported it, and in probably half of the half a dozen cases, the concern was legitimate, and in the other ones, we found out later, once we knew all the facts, that it really was just a PR. That's how it works.
We've reached the end of our time. We have, I think, had an opportunity to expose you to some both very vivid stories of firsthand struggles with this dynamic tension that I talked about at the beginning. I hope some of what you've heard at least inspires you to think about how you might contribute, either as a professional journalist or perhaps in government service, to this larger purpose of national security, and or to ensuring that we have an informed electorate, which in turn ensures that we have a national security. That's the purpose of this project, is to facilitate that kind of awareness and expertise. If you'd like to learn more or participate in it, see me or Bill or others of our team, Trevor is in the background, to figure out how you can participate. And please join me in thanking this extraordinary panel for what they do elsewhere and what they do here.
I'm going to add a gratuitous tip for all of you who decide to go into government or press, have something to do with the CIA. The CIA was born as part of a military organization, the OSS, in World War II. Hence, CIA office are called officers, CIA full-time employees, not agents. CIA officers recruit agents and assets inside bad groups of folks that we want to spy on. But people will know that you aren't familiar with the place at all if you call them CIA agents. If James Bond had been in the CIA, he would have been Officer 007, not Agent 007.
Well, thanks so very much to all of the panelists. That was a splendid conversation. And